good morning, church. Good morning, Cheviot community, and all of those gathering with us online, watching wherever you are from your home. Happy Palm Sunday. This is the Sunday before Easter Sunday, and it is spring, and hopefully you're enjoying this warm weather. When we are in person, we are celebrating with our kids, who will be waving palms, and it's just a wonderful Sunday of celebration, and we're glad that you're here to be with us today. So, if you've never connected with Cheviot United Methodist Church, we just would love to know that you're watching and maybe know a little bit about you and your family. This is a great way by sending me an email. And I have a tendency to respond to emails right away and maybe even invite you out for coffee at some point because I love to do that. Any excuse to get together and meet some new people. So this is a way to connect with us. And these are four new ways that you can give. Many of you are finding that on our website, but you can go to cheviotumc.com, and up at the top, you can click on that giving tab, and it'll walk you through the process. So thank you for all of your giving. And this month, we have a special mission offering. We are donating to United Methodist Committee on Relief, and this is the humanitarian relief agent of the United Methodist Church. This is how your giving spreads and your love spreads around the world in all of the different places that United Methodist Church is serving in mission. So thank you in advance for that special offering in the month of March. We're very excited about a whole new ministry that has begun, our relationship with our friends at Scarlet Oaks Nursing Facility. Many of them, you know, as you know, have been isolated, away from family, away from grandchildren, that kind of thing. And so we are taking Easter to them because we're going to be putting together and taking our kids, grandkids, to get together with their kids and grandkids. And we're having an Easter egg hunt at Scarlet Oaks. And this will be on Saturday, April 3rd, the day before Easter at 2 o'clock p.m., if you've got kids that want to run around, we would love to have them come. We're still collecting toothbrushes and toothpaste for our Redbird Mission trip that's coming up. This is what they've told us they need the most. And so many of you are donating. There's a box in Werner Lounge, and you can continue to bring your donations through April 24th. This is sponsored by Women of Hope. And coming up this coming Thursday, we are entering into Holy Week. And this is the week that we think about that difficult journey to the cross that Jesus took. Thursday evening at 7 p.m., we'll be here with a very special service. This will be in person only. We will not be recording this, but we'll be here to experience the events that took place prior to Jesus' crucifixion and death on the cross, leading us to Resurrection Sunday. So I hope you can take some time out of your week and join us on the 1st of April. And then Easter Sunday, April 4th, we are going to have one service here in the sanctuary. There will be also a recorded version of this, so if you're not able to get to us in person, you can watch online. And this will take place Sunday, April 4th at 10 o'clock a.m. here in the sanctuary or online. So one of the fun things about this series has been being able to get together with many people from our church and discussing this series called The Chosen. And I have Joe Hoff here today, and Joe is one of the folks that's been really religious, being there every week with a lot to say about how this DVD is really making a difference for you. So I'm so glad that you're here so that they can hear some of the things I've been hearing as I've been listening to you on Zoom. So, you know, in general, I think you've really been blessed by this series. It sounds like it. What are some of the things that have been really moving you or blessing you about The Chosen?
I have to agree. Have been blessed by watching the series, The Chosen. Linda and I have both been watching the episodes throughout the first season here. And I think as we go through, and a lot of people before on the Sundays have talked about special scenes that they have seen in the episodes up to that point in time. But this Sunday, we watched, and this week, we watched episode 8, which is the last episode of season 1, and there was so much packed into this last episode that I think there was a lot there that can be discussed, and a lot that Linda and I even chuckle at sometimes with some of the lines and some of the reactions that Jesus got from his followers, and his followers got from Jesus. And so I think in this episode 8, and starting off with Jacob and his three sons, digging the well, and told Salib that this is where they were digging, this is where they were told to dig for the well. And the well ending up later right outside of Samaria. And from a standpoint of that's where the woman at the well.
Yeah.
And I believe her husband, called her Fortina. But the woman at the well. But the whole series was one of these things where we read the Bible. My Bible has no pictures in them. Mm-hmm. And so you form these pictures in your own mind. And then all of a sudden you wish the pictures you could present in color. And all of a sudden this series of The Chosen put everything in motion, in color, to the stories that we have read in the Bible time and time again.
Yeah.
And a couple things here in episode 8 is probably getting into where they were having dinner at Matthew's house before they were all to get together and leave on their journey. And and there they had two priests come to the door, and Jesus told them that it's you know, the healthy do not go see a doctor. It's the doctor there's for the sick.
Yeah.
And so when that came up, it was one of those things where, wow, it's what you remember. Mm-hmm. And now it's put in a scene, and it was all there. And so when you go on and Jesus healed Eden's mother, Simon's mother-in-law, and Jesus told Eden that he was there, there was some things that he wanted to take care of for her before they left on the journey, because he didn't want to put up with Peter or Simon throughout the journey, with him worrying about what was he was leaving at home. So he wanted to be sure that Eden was also taken care of. So he healed Eden's mother from her fever in that. And that was a scene.
And you are right. This is packed with so much. And, you know, one of the things I really appreciate is how it brings in some of the Old Testament stories, which people are like, oh, that's so irrelevant today, but you know, it ties it all together. And you, as a Bible study leader, I know you've led Bible studies, you probably have that really good understanding of both, how it's woven through. I hope that from what Joe has said today, that you will be motivated to watch, even if you've never watched any episode, that you will watch episode 8, and you will get together with us. We hope that this group continues to grow on Zoom tonight at 7 o'clock. And there has been some talk about episode or series 2 coming out right around Easter time. And so we're going to take a break from The Chosen, but be watching for it, because we may pick it back up. And I hope that so many more people join us. Thank you so much, Joe, for sharing what was meaningful for you.
You're welcome. How much more time? Do we have a couple
absolutely.
More minutes?
Absolutely.
One other thing. I'm going to end with how episode 8 ended. And that was when Jesus confronted the woman at the well, and he finally revealed himself as the Messiah. And the whole, I guess, back and forth conversation that he had with Fortina was about worship. And you know, you could only worship and feel in Jerusalem in the temple, and not Samaria. Mm-hmm. And Jesus said to her, "Soon it's all about spirit and truth, and about heart and mind. And that is the only place that you need to be in order to worship. And it wasn't about being on the mountain. No. It wasn't about being in Jerusalem, but it was the beginning of where she was going to tell the public and his public teachings. And Simon was funny there too, because Simon was finally overjoyed. It's like a kid in a candy shop, mm-hmm. where he asked Jesus, he said, "Did you really tell her to go tell the people?" And Jesus says, "Yes, I did." And Simon goes, he gets this big smile on his face, and it was like, this is what we've been waiting for. And Jesus says, we've been sowing for so long. Now the harvest is ripe for picking.
Yeah.
And so...
Isn't that a good word for the church?
Yeah, it is.
Isn't that a good word for the church?
Yeah.
Thank you so much for sharing that with us. And we hope you join us tonight at 7 p.m. on Zoom. See you then.
Please join me in the call to worship. Jesus, you began your journey to the cross this day. We celebrate with you with worship and praise. You rode into this hard and holy week all for us. We can never repay what we have received. May we be reawakened to the priceless gift of the cross. May we have the courage to follow where you lead. Lead us to the cross where your love poured out for us and for the world.
Thank you.
once again, we come to this very special Sunday that launches us into Holy Week and invites us to journey with Jesus from his ride into Jerusalem all the way to the cross at Golgotha and beyond. That is our hope. And it's our hope also in our own lives that whatever we're facing, Jesus takes us on that journey. Sometimes he takes us through times of suffering, times of uncertainty, times of anxiety. And so all of us come to this Sunday from different places, experiencing different life circumstances. But the truth of the cross and the hope we have of Easter that is out ahead of us reminds us that we may never stay in these places when we lift our prayers to the Lord. So I want us to take some time right now. Maybe there's a person on your mind, a family member, a friend, a coworker, a neighbor. Maybe there's a child, a newborn, a college student, a high school student that is on your mind and heart today that needs prayer. Let's take a moment and lift those people who are on our hearts today up to the Lord. Gracious and loving Lord, we celebrate this day with sometimes divided hearts, joyful that you came into to Jerusalem, joyful of the shouts of Hosanna and the people worshiping you, but also distressed about what we know is coming for you. That is our lives, Lord, and you know both the times that we celebrate what we're going through and the times that we, well, fear or dread what we're going through. But you've promised that you will be with us always. So for every name, every face that has come to our mind that we've lifted up this morning that needs a special touch of your healing, whether it be physical, emotional, spiritual healing, we ask that that would be theirs today. And for those prayers that are unspoken, Lord, prayers for ourselves, we trust you with the answer and the timing. We place our hands and our future in yours. And as your disciples who are called to take this journey with you, but also are called to meet you on the shore once you have risen again and receive our assignment, we say this morning that we are ready. We are ready to follow you where you lead. And now we pray together the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We count it a blessing and an honor and a privilege to give. And you are a church of givers, and we are so grateful for you. So as we pray this prayer together, know that you are appreciated, you are thanked that this church exists because of your giving, and people receive the presence of God in their lives because you've given. Let's take a look at a video of one example of how you are blessing the community through your gifts.
Join me in the offering prayer. God of life, we give thanks that our strength is found in you. May your word move within us and renew our faith. May these gifts be used in our community and renew your hope. Amen. Today's scripture reading comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples to them, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
So this morning we find ourselves celebrating Palm Sunday, that moment when Jesus entered into Jerusalem on his way to the cross. And we find ourselves also in our Chosen series at episode 8. When Jesus meets the woman at the well. And our challenge today is to find a way to make these two seemingly disconnected stories connect to each other. Because what Jesus came to do when he got on the back of that donkey and began his journey is what we see happening at the well in Samaria. So my question to start us this morning is, when is the last time that someone said something that changed the course of your life? Years ago, Marlo Thomas wrote a best-selling book called The Right Words at the Right Time. And it's a collection of stories from celebrities who talked about a time in their life when somebody said something to them that they needed to hear. Something that changed their thinking, their way of looking at something that changed the course of their life. It might have been a moment of awakening. It might have been a light bulb moment, a revealed truth about them that they thought no one else knew, or a challenge that moved them to take action. Thomas's belief in writing the book was that each of us carries our own unique set of words, custom-made catchphrases that are intended to move our lives in the right direction. They could be positive words, or at the right time, not so positive words. Like the time that a teacher told Muhammad Ali, "You ain't never gonna be nothing." Words that certainly stung in the moment, but motivated him to make something of himself and his life. Maybe you remember the words of a teacher or a parent or a friend who wasn't afraid to tell you the truth that would move you to a new place in your life. Tom Brokaw, who is the former news anchor and managing editor of NBC Nightly News, you might remember Tom, says that when he was a young journalism student, he spent the first 3 years of his college life wasting his time, ignoring his studies, partying too much, barely passing his classes, and thinking that he was fooling everyone. One day he was surprised that one of his professors invited him to his home for dinner. Thinking that he had impressed his teacher, Tom willingly accepted the invitation and was waiting for what was next until they sat down for dinner. And Bill Farber looked at Tom Brokaw and said, "Tom, I've been thinking a lot about you lately." "Oh, really?" Tom responded. "Yeah, I've been thinking about what you should do with your life. And I believe I have an idea. I think you should drop out of school." "His words crushed me," Brokaw said. But he said them so matter-of-factly, like he was saying something that the world already knew. I immediately felt that I had been caught. "That's right," he said. "I think you should go get all the wine, women, and song out of your system and then come back to school when you can do some good for your parents, for your school, for yourself. But until then, I don't want to see you in my class." Brokaw said, "Well, I took him up on his suggestion and left school. But after about 4 months of struggling to get by, of hand to mouth, trying to make ends meet, I went back to Bill on my hands and knees, asking him to take me back." Sometimes someone knows just the right words to say at the right time. Sometimes those words can come in the midst of an ordinary day. There were few things more ordinary in first century Israel than the daily walk to the well to gather water. It would be kind of like us going to get gas in the car or mailing a letter at the post office. It was usually done first thing in the morning to escape the heat of the day. Women would carry large, heavy jugs on their shoulders and walk the distance to get the precious water. But for one Samaritan woman, her trip to the well happened at a different time of the day, high noon, when she knew that no other women would be there. She was carrying heavy jugs, but she was also carrying something much heavier than the clay pots. She was carrying the shame and regret of a life not well lived, a life that she wasn't proud of. And Jesus had positioned himself there at the well. And that's all that was needed to turn her life around. Let's take a look at this moment when the two meet at the well.
I say, if you knew who I am, you'd be asking me for a drink.
Really?
And I would give you living water.
Would, except that you have nothing to draw water with, and this is a deep well. Besides, what do you need from me if you have your own supply of living water?
Long story.
But Jewish water is better than Samaritan water.
That's not what I said.
Are you a better man than our ancestor Jacob, who dug this well? Your water is better than his?
I know Jacob. And everyone who drinks this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks the water that I give him will never be thirsty again.
Wouldn't that be nice?
The water I give will become in a person a spring of water welling up to eternal life.
Really?
Yes, really.
Prove it.
First, go and call your husband and come back. I will show you both.
I don't have a husband.
You are right. You've had five husbands. And the man you're living with now is not your husband.
Oh, I see. You're a prophet. You're here to preach at me.
No.
Usually the one good thing about coming here alone is I can escape being condemned.
I'm not here to condemn you.
I've made mistakes. Too many. But it's men like you who have made it impossible for me to do anything about it.
How?
Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain. But you Jews insist Jerusalem is the only place for true worship.
They say that because the temple is there.
Yeah. Exactly where we're not allowed.
I'm here to break those barriers. And the time is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father.
So, where am I supposed to go when I need God? I've never received anything from God, but I couldn't thank him even if I did.
Anywhere. God is spirit. And the time is coming and is now here that it won't matter where you worship, but only that you do it in spirit and truth. Heart and mind, that is the kind of worshiper he's looking for. It won't matter where you're from or what you've done. Do you believe what I'm telling you?
Until the Messiah comes and explains everything and sorts this mess out, including me. I don't trust in anyone.
You're wrong when you say that you've never received anything from God. This Messiah you speak of, I am he.
Five powerful words spoken at just the right time. Go call your husband. That's actually four words. But they were powerful words. Because it was exactly what this woman needed to hear and exactly when she needed to hear it. It caused her to come face to face with herself. When all of the conversation about where to worship and who to worship and how to worship melted away, There were just three things left. The woman, the heaviness of what she had been hiding, and the Messiah who had come. And that's all that was needed to change her life. Mike sat in the same seat every Sunday morning. He was a 65-year-old African-American man in poor health and failing eyesight, lived in the low-income apartments near the church. He would sit in the far back corner where no one else would sit. And he sat alone and rarely spoke to anyone. Every Sunday we served lunch and I would make it a habit to sit with Mike and eat with him. And even though I asked him about his life and about his family, he rarely said anything. One Easter Sunday, as we sat eating in silence, Mike pulled out a picture from his wallet and showed it to me. "She's beautiful," I said. "Who is she?" "She's my daughter. That's when she was 14. But I haven't seen her or spoken to her in 20 years. Her mom and I divorced, and her mom said a lot of bad things about me. She turned my daughter against me, and now my daughter wants nothing to do with me." None of it was true, Pastor Carey. That woman ruined my life. All I want to do is see my daughter again. "Do you know where she lives?" I asked. "No, I don't know anything about her." So that morning, Easter Sunday, we bowed our heads together and prayed that Mike would one day see his daughter again. Months went by. Each Sunday, Mike would come shuffling in, barely talking to anyone, except to say, "I just want to see my daughter. I just want to see my daughter." It seemed that God wasn't answering Mike's prayer. Until one day, at his point of desperation, Mike showed up at the church wanting to talk to me. He sat in my office with tears coming down his face, recounting once again how his wife had ruined his life, turned his daughter against him. And that's when the words came to me. "Mike," I said, "I don't know about your marriage. I wasn't there. But unless someone is married to a violent person, an abuser, marriages rarely break up because one person is an absolute angel and the other is a demon. It usually takes two." He looked at me and for the first time said, "Maybe I wasn't the best husband or father. Maybe I made some mistakes too." And the tears rolled down his face. Why don't we spend some time telling Jesus what he already knows then? Would that be all right with you? And we prayed. And Mike left that day for the first time that I had ever seen with a little lightness in his step. A couple of weeks later, I got a call from my secretary. "You'll never believe what happened," she said. "Mike, you know Mike that sits in the back, that doesn't talk to anybody, that Mike, he came in and he wanted me to help him fill out some forms. He was talking about his daughter again and how much he wanted to see her, and so I just asked him, 'Have you ever tried to look her up on Facebook?'" "What's Facebook?" he said. And so I turned on the computer, my secretary said, and I showed him how to set up an account. I showed him where the search bar was, and we typed in his daughter's name, and the first picture that came up was hers. Before he left my office, he had messaged her. She had messaged him back. She had given him her phone number and said, "I would love to talk to you, Dad. It's been so long." The right words at the right time. And the willingness to tell the truth, because Jesus already knows it. Our world today would have us believe that the key to the good life is to hide who we are, to hide what we've done, to keep it to ourselves. And then we wonder why life can feel so heavy some days. We want the good things for ourselves. We want the life that Jesus has promised, but we want it without repentance. There's no freedom in that. Freedom is found when we face who we are and we tell Jesus what he already knows. The woman asked Jesus, "Where do I get this living water?" And his response, "Go and call your husband." The right words at the right time. The Samaritan woman approached the well that ordinary day carrying two heavy clay pots, but she was carrying something much heavier, those parts of her life that she thought she was hiding. And hiding is a heavy burden to carry. But Jesus' words allowed her to leave the well that day a different woman, no longer weighed down by heavy jars, but jumping and running and worshiping, free. On her way to tell others about the man who knew everything that she had ever done. Today, there are people everywhere that are carrying heavy burdens. Maybe that's you this morning. And as we face this Palm Sunday and we journey with Jesus to the cross, are we willing? Maybe his words to us are different than the Samaritan woman's. Maybe his words to us are something like, "Go call your daughter, go call your son, go call your spouse, go call your friend, go call your neighbor." Any relationship that is broken and you have justified that you had nothing to do with it, that's who he wants us to call and to come clean before the one who will go to the cross and die for that sin that we've been trying so hard to hide. We are the Samaritan woman. And we can be set free. The door, the open door, is repentance. Let's pray. Lord, so many of us have carried much with us for so long. It's easy to point fingers at others. It's easy to be the victim. But Lord, you tell us there is no fear in speaking the truth, and that that truth will set us free. So in every heart this morning that needs to be unburdened, will you create space and time and a knowledge, maybe it's just in a casual encounter in the middle of an ordinary day, where we can speak the truth and be forgiven. We ask this in Christ's holy name. Amen.
Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Redemption's hill, where your blood was spilled for my ransom. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as loss. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me, lead me to the cross. You were as I and try, human. The Word became flesh for my sin and death. Now you're risen. Everything I once held dear, to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me, lead me to the cross. To your heart, to your heart, lead me to your heart, lead me to your heart, lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me, lead me to the cross.
Why do we exist as a church? Kind of the same reason that the Samaritan woman ran from the well to tell others who she had met and what he had done in her life. This is our vision, and we each week we read it. So wherever you are, let's join together. Our vision is to connect and serve all people so that lives are transformed and empowered through the love of Christ.
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Thanks for being with us. Until we meet again, we'll see you then.